great, marvelous contrast we've got in this one.
Well, we really do, and it's going to be interesting to me to watch that contrast take place early in the ballgame. I believe Indiana's got to be patient, try to keep this game into a half-court game. That might not be what Bobby wants to do, but I think that's got to be the role. For Vegas, they want to push you up and down the floor, so we're going to see great contrast in this ballgame.
We did not have a classic in that first game, but we might have with this one. We'll come back with the lineups in a moment.
CBS Sports presents the NCAA Basketball Championship. Today's national semifinal game between UNLV and Indiana is sponsored by the Hart.
Bob Knight has coached Indiana for 16 years. He has won two titles. There he is conversing with Gene Corrigan. The two are smiling. They were not smiling last week when Bobby slammed the table. Let's meet the starting lineups. Let's go to Frank Fallon, the PA announcer.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Superdome for this evening's national semifinal game between the Running Rebels of UNLV and the Indiana University Hoosiers. Now, let's meet the starting lineup for UNLV at forward. A 6'8 junior from Rain, Louisiana, number 23, Gerald Patio. For Indiana at forward, a 6'6 sophomore from Cincinnati, Ohio, number 20, Rick Callaway. For UNLV at forward, a 6'9 senior from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, number 35, Armin Gilliam. For Indiana at forward, a 6'7 senior from Westchester, Illinois, number 24, Darrell Thomas. For UNLV at center, a 6'8 junior from Detroit, Michigan, number 44, Jarvis Fastnight. For Indiana at center, a 6'10 junior from San Clemente, California, number 22, Dean Garrett. For UNLV at guard, a 6-foot senior from San Pedro, California, number 10, Mark Wade. For Indiana at guard, a 6'2 senior from Newcastle, Indiana, number 12, Steve Alford. For UNLV at guard, a 6'3 senior from Las Vegas, Nevada, number 13, Freddie Banks. For Indiana at guard, a 6'1 junior from Baton Rouge, Louisiana, number 23, Keith Smart. And now introducing the head coaches for UNLV in his 14th season, Jerry Tarkanian. For Indiana in his 16th season, Bob Knight.
So it is Knight against Tarkanian, and the Running Rebels at 37-1 are favored by 4. We'll be right back. Las Vegas comes here, the winner of the West region. They put away Iowa after trailing by as many as 19 points. For Indiana, they came out of the Midwest region, and they beat an LSU team by 1 point in that regional championship, 77-76. Billy, how about the keys in this game? What should the fans look for early?
Well, I think Indiana's going to try to go inside, use their power game. It'll be interesting to watch how Vegas tries to go ahead and guard Steve Alford. And also to see how Gilliam does inside with his power moves, because you know Jerry Tarkanian can go to that big guy inside that makes the outside even more effective. And let's see if Vegas can shoot the three-pointer where Providence couldn't.
Indiana will wear the white. Vegas will wear the traveling red. Indiana controls. Keith Smart from Baton Rouge, Louisiana. He's come close to home to play in a Final Four. And what a story he is. All these stories will unfold in this game. Rick Callaway, 20, puts it on the floor. Gerald Patio out on him for the Running Rebels.
Do they play that man-to-man?
Banks is on Alford. He didn't pull the trigger early on. They get it in now to Garrett. Garrett on the turnaround over Gilliam with the game's first field goal. The Rebels who come right back down. Mark Wade, one of the best point guards in the land, will key this attack. He seldom shoots. Gilliam is in low, turnaround foul. Dick Picaro is the official who called it. Our referee today is John Clockerty out of Raleigh, North Carolina. Picaro is from Syracuse, and Rusty Herring from Durham, North Carolina. That foul was charged to 24, Darrell Thomas.
Well, Indiana has had a giant advantage in the foul situation and throughout this tournament. So they happen to pick up the first one there. Also interesting, watch how Wade is guarded by Indiana.
Thomas taking Gilliam in this set. Garrett is over on Bass Knight, and now he's able to slough off.
See, Brent, Alford is not guarding Wade. There's two schools of thought there.
Ooh, great jumper.
By Gilliam, the big man inside.
First school is to guard the passer tight so he can't have the passing lane. The second is to lay off. Indiana decides to lay off.
Thomas got another man, and Garrett lost it. Dean Garrett couldn't get a handle on it. Game's first turnover, and the running Rebels come back. We're tied at two. You don't have to worry about a shot clock when Vegas is playing. He traveled, it'll go over to Indiana. That's a turnover, and Bobby Knight barking something out at the end of the bench.
Patio, a one-dimensional player. Jerry Tarkanian said he doesn't dribble it well, doesn't pass it well, but he can shoot it.
Both Knight and Tarkanian are up here early. And Smart was coming inside of Wade and drew the first foul on Vegas.
Wade normally can outrun anybody with the ball, but Smart's one of the best athletes in college basketball.
Billy, can you believe that we've got six junior college graduates out here starting? Now, with Vegas, we know, but what in the world is going on?
Well, if Bobby Knight hadn't had the two junior college players, he would not be in the Final Four, I can assure you.
One of them lost it there, and here comes Wade. Gets it off a beautiful pass, and Bass Knight comes through for the field goal. Banks is going with Alford. The Indiana coaches wondered who would come with him first, and Banks is trailing Alford through that screen-setting offense. Alford pulls it up, and it's going to go against Thomas. That's two fouls on Thomas, down away from the ball. Dick Paparo, a tough official, comes in here and whistles two quick ones.
Notice how Bob Knight kept his cool there. Now that's an off, two fouls away from the ball, been called right there. Thomas away from the ball completely, can't believe it's trying to set the screens inside.
Gilliam on the turnaround. He's two for two from that spot and two field goals. And Vegas breaks to a 6-2 lead.
Brent, if you're not going to play the passer as they're not playing Wade, it gives him an opportunity to pinpoint those passes inside. They may have to go ahead and play a little tighter on him out front.
Callaway brings it up for the Hoosiers. Patio tracks him.
Right, Banks all over off.
Garrett gets it to Smart, who comes to the glass beautifully. Sliced through for the Indiana field goal. Wade right back for the running Rebels. And Patio up with a deuce.
Oh,
slammed in by Jarvis Bass Knight, who skies.
No blockout. You don't find Indiana situation where they don't block out often.
Into Smart again in low, and he draws the foul from Bass Knight. Let's take a look at Bass Knight on the dunk at the offensive end.
Shot goes up. Patio really didn't have it in his hands, but put it up anyway. Now watch, everybody in Indiana turns their head. They don't put a body on anybody. Garrett figures he can outleap Bass Knight, but that's not the case. You've got to put a body on the great quick leapers from UNLV.
That's
smooth, huh?
Yes, indeed. And you know, we've got a McDonald's All-American out there in Freddie Banks. Well, here's a young man who was flipping McDonald's in Baton Rouge for a year. He was cooking the burgers down there as Keith Smart. UNLV, 4 of 5 from the field. Indiana, 3 of 3. So this game starts out dramatically different than the first one. Wade is left alone, and he takes a three off the iron. Thomas controlling. Here's Smart, and a beautiful defensive move by Wade. That was going to be a breakaway, but he knocked the ball out of bounds. Well, we've got the largest crowd ever for a college basketball game watching the Final Four here in the Dome, 64,959. And folks, not everybody has a perfect seat here, I might point out. We're going to show you a couple of them. Thomas puts it down, comes to the glass, scored the field goal, and Thomas's third personal foul. Offensive foul, field goal, and Steve Isle becomes the man of the moment for Indiana.
Well, that's a tough break for Indiana because they are not a very deep bench. We have Bob Knight acting like the gentleman over there. Excellent defense inside. Patio just holds his ground, goes chest to chest. Kind of a touch foul. I think a no call was the best call in that play.
He was being a gentleman, but he was saying to Paparo, "You're the one that got him in trouble with that second foul." You said it nicely.
Boy, they're just leaving Wade wide open. He's got to put up a couple of shots. Nice dish.
Gilliam has been perfect. Misses with the left hand. Loose. Alford in a foot race. Rebels get it. Wade to Patio. He jacks the three.
You know, Indiana has been a slow starter in this tournament. Remember, we saw him against Auburn way behind. slow against LSU, and they're starting a little bit slow here today.
Here's Steve Isle, who came off the bench, number 32. Good all-purpose sub. A little bit slow of foot here to the Mexican Vegas. We'll see how he compensates, and underneath, it's going to come back the other way.
Well, they're giving Callaway a push.
You bet. Underneath, so it'll go on over. And now, Knight gives Paparo still another blast as he walks by. That's four team fouls on Indiana and two on Vegas. And the Shark is not saying a thing. He puts his hand over his mouth. He didn't want to say anything the way it's going. There's a three from Banks. They're two and three with the threes. And Bass Knight knocks the ball out of bounds. And you've got to be impressed with the quickness that Vegas has shown Indiana early in this game.
Brent, they're not only quick, they've got size with quickness, and that's really hard to handle.
Smart, and he was fouled.
That's two on Wade. Look for Jerry Tarkanian to come back with Graham, which doesn't really hurt him too much in his ball game. Might even help him a little, because Graham then could go over on Alford and free up Banks not to have to work so hard on defense. See, he doesn't want to play a smaller man on Alford. Here comes Graham into the ballgame.
Graham is a 6'4 senior. He played for Bob Wade, Dunbar High School, back in Baltimore before Wade moved to the Maryland job. And Wade will sit down, but they will miss that leadership out on the floor. And Alford, right away, has drawn Graham just as you figured he would. Better.
Boy, people who think Vegas can't play some defense are crazy. They play as tough a man-to-man as you'll see in college ball.
It's a very aggressive defense. Isle gets to the glass, wasn't sealed off, taps it in. It's 14-11, UNLV over Indiana. Graham's three-pointer, and Isle rebounds.
Graham didn't even get a sweat up here and is putting up threes.
Alford maneuvering.
Nice defense.
Gets it back from Isle. Side to Garrett. Here comes Smart sliding through. He crashes down and he's fouled. It'll go against Vegas.
Well, if you're Jerry Tarkanian, you don't want to see somebody try to draw a charge and a guy that's shooting an off-balance layup. Might as well let him shoot.
Billy, one of the most important parts of this game was probably the meeting of the three officials and looking at this. We've had 18 fouls called in this game already. We've got Thomas out of the Indiana lineup for three. Four against UNLV, four on Indiana. Now, they have established right off the top that this is going to be a tightly officiated game. And if they maintain it, the athletes on the floor can say, all right, we know the rules and we'll play by them. It's if consistency is lacked in the second half that you begin to have trouble with coaches.
I think these referees saw the game between LSU and Indiana. And they're not going to let this one get out of hand at all.
Banks bringing it down. The rare times you see this team slow it up. And not for long. Smart with him. Callaway out on patio. Here's Bass Knight coming around aisle. Went to the left hand, but you could see the quickness in there. Garrett cleans up, rebounding. Now Indiana can tie it.
Well, good help by Bass Knight.
Alford quickly with his initial shot. Tapped away by Bass Knight. Here come the Rebels. Patio has it knocked away beautifully by Callaway.
You know, that's a defensive move a lot of guys are getting to be very good at. Stripping a man of the ball as he goes up for the jump shot instead of going for the block.
Alford on the drive, tosses it up and ties the game at 14. Steve Alford's first field goal here. And it's turned over. Banks lost it on the dribble. On the turnover, it'll go back to the Hoosiers. We got a television timeout here in New Orleans. It's 14-14. 14-27 left in the first. 6 of 9. Steve Alford, 1 of 2. And Billy Packer, show everybody how Indiana gets Alford open.
Nobody in college basketball moves better without the ball than Steve Alford. So here's inside with Alford. Here he's going to move, try to rub his man off a screen inside. When the switch is created, Alford will pull out to the side. If the defense goes for the switch, Garrett or Thomas will move inside looking for the inside power play. Or outside to Steve for the three-pointer.
And they now have an opportunity to go ahead here in this game. After that turnover, it's Indiana's ball. David Willard, number 40, on the floor for the first time for Jerry Tarkanian. Eldridge Hudson, number 33, also has checked in. And Garrett gets behind Willard. got the field goal.
Brent Willard is a good offensive shooter, but not a good defender. Great move by Indiana to go immediately at him defensively. Not the only weak defensive player on the UNLV team.
Hudson gets it to Willard. And it's Vegas's ball. You know, Wade, before he went out with those two personals, had dished out five assists.
Well, he's the all-time assist leader in single season in the history of college basketball.
Indiana on a run of seven straight points here against Vegas right now.
Trying to take Garrett. Nothing there. Good defense by Garrett.
Now he turns on the man, and Holloway yanks the rebound. Oh, throws it to Banks and gets it to Gilliam.
4-point turnaround on that steal. Bobby Knight real upset with that one. He had two going one way and loses it two the other way.
Deadlocked again, 16 all, 13:29 to go.
Sarkanian changed assignment.
Garrett's in low again behind Willard. He drew the foul from Willard. He'll come to the free throw line.
Jerry Tarkanian can forget about Willard being able to help Garrett.
I think Tarkanian will probably switch, Billy.
Now, he's getting a lot of help from his assistants right now. Timmy Gingrich is saying the same thing. Got to get somebody inside to play Garrett.
They can move Gilliam or Hudson and try and see what they can get defensively with that matchup. They do not want to get Gilliam into any kind of foul trouble over here. So now the Las Vegas coaches have a decision to make because Garrett is hitting him behind Willard. And let's see, when they come down the floor the next time, we'll check that matchup.
Brent, about the only thing they could do is put Willard on Isle because Isle's not going to be a big scorer anyway.
Now at this end, Isle for Knight takes Willard. Hudson and Callaway was there. So Indiana's ball. Check the inside matchup, Billy. Who gets Garrett?
Well, they can't change yet.
Offered. A three-pointer.
I think
Paparo was late in getting his arms up, but it was a three, and Banks answers with a missed one. But it's going to be run down by Vegas.
And there's one of the things Vegas does well, get the wide rebound. I think Vegas is really out of sync right now with the team they have on the floor.
Garrett fronts Gilliam, frustrating him on this side, but they get a ball in low to him anyway. Missed the shot, and Hudson hammers it away.
No block out from the weak side. Well, when Gilliam gets the ball, everybody from IU is really there.
Now Smart will operate at the point and offer to look for the screens. And yes, Willard does come out on aisle. Smart comes up with that great leaping ability, hits the field goal, 23-18, Indiana leading. Banks charges through Smart. Offensive foul, that's his first.
And with Wade out of the ball game, you see how important he is. He's coming back in now, but how important he is to Jerry Tarkanian's club. They really have gotten out of sync offensively. Willard's going to sit down. Banks has got to sit down.
He is one of the great leaders in college basketball. As Willard and Banks sit down, Wade, number 10, returns along with Jarvis Bassnighten. There is the team leader. He played down at Oklahoma, transferred to a junior college, and then came to UNLV. This team responds to him verbally, and he also sets the example. He leads him on and off the floor. He's a remarkable young man.
Tell me Steve Isle isn't doing a job as a sub.
Comes all the way to the glass for the layup. He's doing a great job.
Why he's so valuable, he can play any one of three positions. He goes back in the guard spot. He plays inside defensively. He can play the forward spot.
Gilliam brings Garrett way out. They look for Gilliam. That jump hook is not there in Callaway's skies. Now Alford brings it down for the Hoosiers. 25-18, Indiana leading Vegas. Great pass to Smart, looking it off. And Smart couldn't hit it, and Gilliam brings it down for the Rebels. Here's Wade. Now it's Gilliam alone at the free throw line. He'll hammer that shot away.
That's where Garrett has to be really careful. You can't wait for Gilliam to come down and post up because from about 16, 18 feet, he can drill the jump shot.
Wade is taking Alford. That's the third Rebel who has been assigned to Alford. Isle out there with a hard screen, and Wade slashes through it. Now comes up with a defensive play.
That's
Alford came back on him and fouled him.
Well, Wade is so quick. And Jerry Tarkanian did not want to use Wade on Alford if he could help it. He felt he needed a bigger man to stop that jump shot.
one of the keys to the defensive strategy that we saw put in at the Vegas practice. They're not going to switch off. They want their men to slash through the screens, and Wade did that time and stayed with his man. Gilliam down in low, and Callaway, who's doing a job on the glass. Loose, he's come up with it, and here's Alford.
Indiana's really weak, Brent, when Gilliam gets the ball, because they put so many men on him, there's nobody there in case he misses the rebound.
Callaway off the dribble.
Forced it.
And Gilliam underneath was fouled by Isle. He's going to go to Vegas. So along with Billy Packer, I'm Brent Musburger. A crowd of 64,959, a record for a college basketball game. Watching Indiana shoot 71% from the field, Vegas 45%, and Thomas on Knight's bench with three quick personals. But still, Indiana leads by five. 10:30 to go here in the first half. Graham's open, and Isle switched out and influenced the shot.
Graham's pulling up the trigger on his jump shot, but that was a great screen by Wade.
Wade would not give Alford an inch. Now he comes through the screens. He's got daylight. And Garrett is there.
Neither team blocking out very well on missed shots.
Eight for Garrett. And what has to please Knight so much is Isle's performance, because Thomas is on the bench with three personals. Two shots. There's a foul down inside. And it's going to go against Graham. They're going to shoot two at the other end. Paparo looked inside.
Brent, that's some good piece of officiating, because a lot of times you see officials looking only at the ball. There's a case where Paparo was really looking off the ball for the play. Let's see it inside, who it's going to be called on here.
It's on Graham, away from the ball on the far side. He took him right down to the ground, and Smart will shoot the free throws here at the other end. Freddie Banks and Gerald Patio return for Tarkanian. 17 fouls against Vegas and six against Indiana, and we reach a point where the Shark says, I got to get the towel out.
He got it out early today. I watched him nibbling over there about a minute ago. Pete Smart exploded. The first time we had him on CBS this year was against Ohio State. Alford having a rough day, but Smart did the job to pull IU back to a big victory.
We've got a television timeout. We're near the 10-minute mark. Indiana leads Vegas by nine. Courtside, we have an excellent view, but James Brown, what about some of the other seats here in this vast dome?
Well, Brent, even with the fans who are sitting up here, you got to wonder. 64,000 fans here, the largest crowd ever, unobstructed views everywhere, but those fans who are sitting 27 stories above the action and paid $17.50, you got to wonder if they're getting their money's worth. As a matter of fact, one fan I talked to said that from up here, the game is nothing but a rumor. Brent?
Thank you, James. Vegas hit five of its first eight shots. Since then, only 4-13 against this position man-to-man defense of Bob Knight's. It's the pressure defense of the Running Rebels against position man-to-man. They drop it to Gilliam, Isle in low, and they send it back to Wade. Patio, he's one of the threes, and he hits one, his second of the game. They are 3 of 5. Isle puts it on the floor, and Bass Knight takes him, and here's Garrett up over Gilliam, but he traveled coming off the fake.
Gilliam underrated as a defensive post player. Holds his position very well, moves his feet, then go ahead and slap with the hands. Patio's feeling warmed up with that three. He'd like another one.
Loose on the floor, and Smart dove back in on the ball against Gilliam, and it was turned over, went out of bounds first. So it'll be Indiana's ball, and Vegas sets the pressure, and Smart breaks deep. Comes inside, Gilliam hits the layup against the full court pressure defense. Bob Knight will do that. He did it in the rematch against Iowa. He says you just go all the way when they set the full court press. That's the best attack against it. Patio's second three here in the last few seconds. Long rebound off the hard rim, and Alford got a ball on it, and Callaway, who has played extremely well here so far, wraps it up.
Did you notice when Patio knew that shot was off, how he took off to go get the rebound? Alford showing some pretty good ball handling and passing out here today, as opposed to his normal shooting. Gets caught
open. It was a little flat for Steve's shot. He's missed a couple from that spot over there. In that first game, we had some poor shooting. Banks pulls up.
A great hesitation dribble. Just throws the defender. Teams are slowing down a little bit right now. It's like they lost it. Looking for that second win.
Holloway tried to get a field goal and couldn't. It's 31-25. The quarterback brings it down. Adio off the move. The three not there.
When he misses very, very badly. Boy, I'd go crash that board. He throws some hard bricks up there. Normally a great three-point shooter is a guy that has it always soft around the rim.
Garrett on a quick turnaround, and Gilliam fouled him. That's his first personal foul for the Hammer.
Give you an idea about IU going to the foul line. In the tournament so far, they've been there 116 times. Their opponents only 61 times. That's 55 differential.
So far, Vegas has not shot a free throw in this game. Indiana Garrett gives Indiana 7 of 8 at the free throw line. And Indiana has enjoyed an enormous edge because not only do they get to the line, they have been hitting them in the tournament. And they build a 33-25 lead, 7:47.
Hitting them, they're shooting 82% from the foul line.
Across the patio, maneuvers, and Garrett blocked it.
Look at Isle, just wave off. Alford said, I'll bring it up. So valuable to have a sub that can play multiple positions.
Holloway cut off. They get it back to Isle.
That was a good cutoff by Bassnight.
Inside to Alford. Gets Banks away from him with the body and then hits the two. Wade comes right back. It's a 10-point lead. Biggest of the game. Gilliam at the line.
Should have been a foul on Garrett sticking his hand in his face after the shot. That's the second time he's come down and pulled up, taking that little 16, 17 footer.
Near the 7-minute mark, Gilliam had a hand. Ball went out of bounds, Indiana's ball, and Gary Graham, senior guard, checks in.
The guy that's
Patio sits down.
Brett, the guy that's tired right now is Garrett, but he doesn't have anybody that's going to go in for him the remainder of this half. Push
Banks.
Banks.
That's his second personal.
Game is being called very tight. Very tight.
Right from the beginning. Now Alford, who is one of the best, as you might imagine, from the free throw line. He has hit 22 of 25 in the tournament. 88%.
Now, one of the top free throwers in the NBA was one of his idols when he was growing up, Jerry Seasting, who plays for the Celtics, played for Steve's dad. High school. Kid's been a gym rat all his life. Has the stroke.
It's 10 again. Galloway sticking with Graham outside. They get into Bassnight. Alford reaching in has assessed the personal. That's his second. So the winner of this game meets Syracuse for the national championship Monday night. In case you didn't see the score, Syracuse eliminated Providence 77-63 in our opening game. Here it is, Indiana against Vegas, 37-27, Indiana, 6:48 in the first. Billy?
Brent, on that last play, you could see Steve Alford let Banks go completely. Now Banks, excuse me, let Wade go completely. What Wade has got to realize that if he's not going to be played, he's got to start taking up the slack a little bit so he can get the ball back and make the good pass or take an occasional shot to keep Alford honest.
Bassnight misses the Rebels' first free throw on the 1-on-1. Save by Isle. Ships it to Alford. Boy, this is a quality performance by Isle off Knight's bench. Gilliam taking Garrett.
Nice man-to-man defense by Graham.
Wade switches over on Smart. Alford couldn't do anything with Graham, so he sends it back to Isle.
Clinic by Graham right there.
Winds up in Callaway's hands. Now it's Steve's three.
Yes, and a good call by the ref. Graham stuck him right in the chest with his hand on the shot. Hartanian wants a time. Good refereeing. I said before that Garrett did that on Gilliam, but it wasn't called. These refs are right on top of this game.
Indiana 40, UNLV 27. through that play a moment ago.
Well, Graham gives a cheap shot to Alford right there. Now, that wasn't a big physical deal, but whenever you gain an advantage with contact, which was the case there on that particular play, the official wisely made the call. Graham found himself trying to help out inside, and if you're playing Alford, never go help out inside. You better stay right with him face to face.
Now, Indiana led 9-8. It was 17-01. Thomas got his third personal foul. Since then, they have outscored Tarkanian 32-19. Joe Hillman replaces Steve Alford, who takes a break here in the first half. Now, Isle, who came in, has scored 4 points, but he has pulled down 4 rebounds, and he's played strong defense. Look at the quick double on Gilliam, and so from the corner.
Oh, what a
running
shot.
Three from the deep part of that corner.
Are you kidding me? Fading away, going to the deep corner with a good man on him.
Vegas team was down 19 to Iowa. I think it was about 18 early in the second half, and still they were able to come back. A lot of firepower Indiana faces here. Here's Isle, he's got an opening, tried to dish it off, the defense was there, Callaway beautifully follows it up. Now Joe Hillman positions the defense, Wade is cut off.
Hillman didn't show up on the stat sheet as even having played against LSU, but may have been one of the most valuable minutes we've seen all year.
Gilliam on the turnaround, he had a 3-point play, knocked out by Bassett. He had a 3-point play and he fouled out Dale Brown's strongest defender in that game.
He really did a good, smart job leading the ball club. Like I said, it played less than a minute in the game, so he didn't officially show up in the stat sheet.
Eldridge Hudson is the rebel who just checked in, and Smart is rejected.
There he is again.
Joe Hillman following up.
It seems like Vegas is making one effort on every play, and Indiana making two, and that's why they're capitalizing on it.
The three from Banks, the other side. 11 points for Banks. And Vegas is 5 of 10 shooting threes. Stolen by Wade. They can work a run faster than any team you want to see. Hudson goes to the glass.
Now, Bobby Knight has taken a calculated risk here, taking Alford out of the game. He may have to bring him back in quickly. Yeah, he's getting him up off the bench right now. He cannot afford, as did Jerry Tarkanian, making substitutions into that bench. They're not ready to play in a game like this.
Here's Callaway. Back to Isle. He tracks it down.
Isle wants to go right with that dribble.
Give to Hillman, and Gilliam with another strong block. And this time the Rebels come out. Banks with a three. Tapped in at the glass by Hudson.
Hey, here's a, this is a big run. Now, Bobby Knight doesn't want to call a time here, but he may have to take one. He's got Alford trying to get back in the game. He might not be able to get him back in quickly enough.
45-39. Garrett, and he ends it. A huge hoop for Indiana at the 340 mark. Here comes that pressure again. And Gilliam fouled and scored and bring him to the free throw line.
You know, Wade pushes that ball up the court, Brent, so positively that you can see how Vegas plays with him in the game. When he's not in there, this ball club not anywhere near as effective.
Knight questions Pabarl.
Gently questions.
Wade has dished out 11 assists. Patio replaces Banks for UNLV at the 333 mark. 47-41, Indiana over the Rebels right now.
That puts Wade up over 390 assists on the year. Last year he set an assist record of 283, so he's beaten it by 100 at Vegas, and he breaks Mark Jackson all-time NCAA record. And look at who's got that ball in his hands right now.
That's 15 points for Gilliam.
Ooh, what a screen by Isle.
Against the double, they get it to Isle. Got to be an open
Alford's
man.
Open.
Comes inside on the penetration. Couldn't get it to fall, but Garrett cleans it up. That's two big field goals by Dean Garrett. He and Hudson collide coming out.
Both of these teams are really well coached, but I've never seen two teams this well coached that have given up that many second shots by bad blocking out.
What a knocked away by Smart and out of bounds. Vegas will work an inbounds play.
Gillum has great hands on the inside. Was a football player up to his junior year in high school. Recruited by a lot of people.
They wanted to play tight end. South Carolina was among the schools. West Virginia, another one.
And then was not highly recruited as a basketball player.
Wade's three is short. Alford has it. Indiana pulls it up. Now Alford comes in all the way, and Gilliam is there with another block. He's been a monster inside. Graham coming through. Drew the foul. And so Gary Graham, with the third personal on Steve Isle, moves to the free throw line.
They are fun to watch on the break. It just gets exciting as they cross at half court. You know they're all moving. They really fill the lanes. Alford thought he had it made. Excellent timing on the inside by Gilliam. Here's Steve. He's beating him around the corner. There's no place to go. Gilliam times it perfectly and starts the break.
Richard Robinson has checked in against Knight for Vegas. He'll wear 00. He's in the middle on the far side there on the free throw line with Graham at the line. Knight is having a few calm words over there with Papa.
Well, Bobby Knight, you know, a master of working at sidelines and knows with this particular crew, particularly after what happened in the LSU game, this crew's not going to put up with any of his nonsense. So he's trying to gently work him as opposed to going after him with that violent attitude he showed in the LSU game. Nice help by Hudson.
Now Robinson is taking Garrett, and they try to get it in low to him. Tarkania with a few fouls to give in that situation. And Bob Knight will try Todd Meyer, number 30. Boy, Steve Isle is going to get a round of applause from the Indiana fans.
And a pat by Bob Knight. That's a quality minutes. Just like we saw in the first game, Brower coming in and giving those quality minutes. Not a lot of stats, but good quality minutes.
Callaway. It's going to be a thoroughbred. Only a sophomore. 51-43 Indiana. Approach the 210 mark here.
Not even Garden Wade.
Graham on the pull-up was fouled by Smart. That's his first personal. And now Graham comes up to the free throw line. He's been averaging better than 12 points a game in the tournament so far. Wondering about the shooting percentage he takes in the first half. Indiana at 61% and UNLV at 51%. Just think back to what we had in the first game. What a difference we're seeing here. And Banks comes back with 11 points and Patio sits down.
Been a lot of the statistics there in regard to the high percentage that caused by second shots. Easy rebounds on the inside. Graham, who stroked two real good foul shots against Iowa, has looked poor in the last two.
No violations now. No fouls.
Gilliam returns. Hudson goes out.
Graham's brother, an outstanding shooter for the University of Maryland. Boy, he hasn't looked good on one yet.
Meyer rebounding. Alford bringing it up on Banks. Meyer to set the screen. Knocked away and out of bounds. It'll go over. Touch last by Smart. Wade comes with a long pass, and Smart was able to come back and knock it out of bounds.
Well, against a good athlete, you don't want to take that chance. A minute 53 to go. I was surprised Indiana went a little bit better with the ball there. And you're not going to get it all back so quickly.
Banks.
What are they going to call that, a shot?
Call on Smart, his second personal.
Foul is charged to number 23.
Believe he signaled 1-on-1.
Yeah, 1-on-1.
And now they will try Cree Smith off Knight's bench. He's a 6'7 junior. So he has Meyer, Smith, Garrett, Callaway, and Alford out against Gilliam, Robinson, Graham, Banks, and Wade. 149. Trouble at that line. And Gilliam rising up. He's fouled on the shot, and he'll come to the free throw line. Garrett working away on him. He picks up his first personal.
Brent, both of these coaches will look at this film later this summer and wonder how so many second shots have taken place, because they're normally very good at blocking out inside, particularly fundamentally sound on a foul shot. We saw Syracuse get an awful lot of second shots or second rebounds off missed free throws.
And that's been the difference in the scoring. 51-43 as a result of that. Indiana with the lead. Now it's 51-44. Gilliam with 16 points here in the first half.
Well, Gilliam, known as the Hammer, got his nickname from Spoon James. How'd you like to get a nickname from a guy called Spoon? Now that's scary. This is the second free throw shooting, really hurting UNLV.
Banks all over Smith.
He better give up the ball because Banks will take it from him.
Shifts back to Callaway. Open is Smith.
Double team. Somebody's got to be open. It could be Alford.
He pulled it back out. And they're off of Meyer pretty much. Here he is. Now it's Bree Smith coming in. Callaway gets two fake. Goes to the glass for the layup. Is he going to be a big timer or what?
John Thompson taking a look at this game may be thinking Olympic material for that guy.
You bet. Now it's Vegas' turn.
And they've been quiet from three range here of late. Banks got Smith on him. He can get one off. He's a lot quicker.
Alford sloughs on Wade. Here's Banks. He comes up over him and hits the three. Good call, Mr. Packard.
Well, he's being played by a man not quick enough to stay with him out there. Boy, Vegas is doing a lot of double teaming here. And when you double team Indiana, they'll find the open man. There he is.
Callaway.
Almost walked. Bobby Knight works on this semi-delay a lot. Very difficult to double-team one of his teams.
Shot clock is turned off. Indiana bringing it down. Bree Smith was the open man. Tracks it down. And then missed the layup underneath. And Robinson comes out. They'll have to hurry. Graham at the buzzer. The end of the first half. And it's been a good one. Knight and Indiana lead Tarkanian and Vegas 53-47. Jim Nance and James Brown are standing by. We'll return to the Superdome after this message and a word from your local stations.
The Superdome, game two in the national semifinals. Indiana outscoring UNLV in the first half, 53-47. Dean Garrett with 14, Steve Alford with 13, and the Hoosiers have a 6-point lead. Jim Nance back with you on our set here at the Superdome. And I'm joined now by my CBS Sports colleague, Billy Cunningham, along with Jim Boeheim, the winner in our first game this afternoon. Coach Boeheim, congratulations. What's going through your mind now, an hour after that?
Well, I felt real good for about 5 minutes. Then I started watching these two teams play, and I don't feel so good right now.
Jimmy, that appeared to me to be the best defensive effort you've had from this ball club this year.
Well, I think our defense has been a little underrated. We led the conference in field goal percentage defense this year and last year, and we played good man-to-man both times we beat Providence. So I think we're a little bit better than people give us credit for, but today was excellent.
Coach, tell us what happened here. You had an 18-point lead in the second half. And then an altercation took place. Tell us about this.
Well, it was a normal Big East scuffle. You know, we get in these all the time. They were just locked up and, you know, just one of those things. And we just, you know, a guy came in and hit Coleman, and I just tried to get out there and separate them. But up to that point, we played the best we could possibly play, offensive and defensive. And from that point on, we just hung on. We were just struggling.
Momentarily, that seemed to ignite Providence. They went on a 9-0 tear, but then your team came back with another big play.
Well, when they went on that tear, we just felt we had to hold the ball, spread them out, try to slow the game down a little bit. And our kids have handled the ball well in that situation all year, and they did it.
Jimmy, for you guys to win the championship, okay, Monday night, is there any key phase of the game or a key player you think that's got to play an outstanding game?
Billy, we've done it with balance all year long. Syracuse has always been a balanced team offensively and defensively, and the way we can be successful is by being balanced. We were that today, and that's, I think, the overall key to our team. When everybody's involved, then we're a good basketball team.
The Big East this year, you know, it's supposed to be down year for the Big East, and we see them, the two teams in the Final Four. Why? I mean, why does this happen?
Well, the conference is very competitive, as you know, from seeing some of the games that you saw. It's a war every night, and I think that gets you ready. The Big East tournament helps get you ready. But, you know, I just think that this happens to be our year. We've had good success in the 8 years, and mainly because I think of the commissioner, the organization of the league, the way it's been set up has been done the right way, and it's helped all the coaches get the best possible program that they can have.
Billy, quickly, what do you think will happen in the second half? I know Jimmy can't really comment on it, but what do you think?
Well, the one thing Indiana cannot do is relax for 1 second, because we saw last week where Iowa let up a little bit, and UNLV is going to come at you for the next 20 minutes of this game.
All right, Billy, thank you, and congratulations again, Jim Boeheim.
Thanks.
We'll see you Monday night in the championship game, and we'll come back in just a moment, and Bobby Knight in his own words as we continue from the Superdome in New Orleans. That's outside of the Superdome. Indiana leading UNLV 53-47. The winner will go on and play Syracuse for the national championship on Monday night. Now in golf at the TPC, the UNLV locker room. James?
All right, Jim, thank you very much. Interestingly, the Rebel players, when they came off the court at halftime, they were smiling. And the reason is because a couple of the players said that their problems are easily resolvable. Indiana was using players other than Keith Smart, and Steve offered to bring the ball up the court to neutralize their pressure defense. But the main reason for the smiles, even though they're down by 7 points, is that they have Indiana into a running game, and that's their game. They feel they have Indiana right where they want them. Back to you, Jim.
All right, James. Perhaps the most dominant figure coming into this Final Four was Bobby Knight of Indiana. He played in the Final Four 3 times on those great Ohio State teams. Now he's coaching in his 4th Final Four. Well, we talked with Bobby yesterday, and here, in his own words, is what he looks for when a youngster comes to Indiana looking to carry on that Hoosier basketball tradition.
Over the 16 years, we've had every personality imaginable. I mean, we've had some very passive kids that have played extremely well. We've had very aggressive kids that have played very well. We've had talkative kids. We've had quiet kids. I think it's just simply a matter of a kid saying to himself, hey, I want somebody to push me to the fullest. I want to find out how far I can go. I want to be the best I can. And in doing that, I'm going to do what I have to do. Now, if you have an idea on how basketball ought to be played, and you're going to stick to that idea, then you're going to have a tough time with me, because I've got an idea on how basketball ought to be played, and I've worked at a hell of a lot more than you have. I think a kid has to know how far he can go. I mean, most of us don't. We're tired, but we aren't tired. We're hungry, but we aren't hungry. We're sleepy, but we aren't sleepy, and we got to know when we aren't. I don't ever want a kid to have to come back and say, Coach, I need to borrow some money because I'm not successful. I mean, I want him to be successful so I can go to him and borrow money. There have been 2 kids that have played for me 4 years that haven't graduated yet. And that upsets me, because I think they all should graduate. That's my responsibility. I tell them that when they come. 50%, 40%, 75%, none of that's good. They're there to get an education, not to play basketball. And I don't think anything less than everybody accomplishing what the intent of his enrollment was is satisfactory. They all think I'm a lot easier today than I was when they played. Doesn't make any difference. Every kid that comes back, it's like, boy, you ought to played for him 5 years ago, or 10 years ago, or last year. There's a big change in him between then and they change. You know, it's the same.
Bobby Knight happy at the moment. His Hoosiers shooting 59% from the floor in a 6-point halftime lead. Transplant. The estimated cost for that procedure is $125,000. And Mark Wade, a guard for the Running Rebels, took up the cause this week at a luncheon.
Miller highlights. Miller made the American way since 1855. Mazda cars and trucks. The more you look, the more you like Mazda value. And by AT&T, the right choice.
Well, Billy Packer, as Jerry Tarkanian now begins to hustle out here toward the court. We've got 6 seconds left toward the start of the second half. The Vegas players just filing out on the floor. They're not even getting an opportunity to warm up. That's very unusual.
It really is. I wonder if somebody forgot on Jerry's part to let his club know what the time was left on the clock. You can't come out without getting a little bit warm. And I'll be shocked if they could come out. Freddie Banks, example, never even touched the ball. They may start the second half without Jerry on the bench.
Now, the locker rooms are quite a ways out, and you can see Tarkanian battling his way through the crowd. We're ready to get it started here as Jerry joins the team at the bench. Indiana came out with about how much time on that clock to shoot around?
Well, normally you want to get yourself 3-4 minutes, and I think Jerry's saying that we weren't notified, but that's a big mistake on the part of somebody from UNLV to not let people know when they were going to go ahead and start this second half.
And you're saying, Billy, it is difficult for the players to start out cold and be loose.
Impossible. I mean, you've got to come out and get a couple of shots up. Now, this is a club that's in great physical condition, but you want to at least touch the ball a little bit.
Now, Knight is saying, when that goes to 20, you get them out here and let's play. I was ready. Let's get at it. So Bob Knight, he was a different sort of a leader in the first half regarding the officials. Billy, tell us about it.
In my opinion, Bobby Knight knew he overstepped his bounds. And you did a great job with him, Brent. I'm not smoking you a little bit, but you did a great job talking about that technical foul and that he deserved it in the last game against LSU. He got himself a little over the edge in that game, maybe a way over the edge. Probably should have been slapped for at least another technical. He knew it. He came into this game. He's been very passive on the bench. Look for him the second half, maybe to go that same way because the officials are keeping an eye on him.
All right. It is a 6-point difference as we start the second half. Indiana 53, UNLV 47. In Vegas and the traveling Reds, and Wade with a three is off, and Alford pulls it down. We get word from the table that the NCAA committee does not have any responsibility. It is up to the team. They know how much time there is when they leave the floor to get back out and warm up. They want it smart off his hand, out of bounds on the turnover. It's Vegas ball.
Good quickness on the part of Wade, trying to get the little back door cut, but UNLV is going to have to run up and down this court a couple of times to get loose. You can see that brick that Wade threw up the last time down. Tough to come out and make a shot if you haven't warmed up. Alford's not even guarding Wade. Foul.
Missed the three. And they lose it back to Vegas. Bass Knight to Gilliam.
Wade again with those quick hands. Causing trouble. Wade got in foul trouble in the first half, and I think that's what cost UNLV greatly because it really got him out of sync with him off the floor.
Garrett traveled. That's two quick turnovers here as we start the second half, and 10 total for the game for the Hoosiers. Down to four. Away from the ball, down on the inside. Smart and Banks entangled down there. And that for Smart is his third personal. So he breaks the assist record that had been set by, among others, Mark Jackson of Georgetown and Milt Wagner of Louisville.
Mix up on the out-of-bounds sideline call. Now we have another problem. Garrett came down on his ankle. He's all right. He didn't want to come out of there. Indiana starting very slow, so maybe my theory goes right out the window.
Everybody, keep your players locked up until just before you start.
Believe me, it won't happen again to UNLV if they're fortunate enough to advance in this tournament.
Alford, he was wide open when he turned on that shot.
Got free on the inside and those great screens that Indiana runs inside.
55-51. Banks, and there's his fifth three of this game. He is 5 of 7 now from three-point range.
And Banks had not been shooting well coming into this ball game and so far in the tournament, only shooting 33% from the three-point line. Maybe five. Mark Wade over there smiling at Bobby Knight. He likes to go ahead. He put that smile on Iowa a time or two.
It's a great story out here for Indiana as I see Steve Isle starting the second half. Now, as you all know, Darryl Thomas is normally a starter, but he picked up three fouls, and he's been on the bench since early in the first half. The reason he did not start is because Bob Knight remembers an incident when he was at Ohio State playing for Fred Taylor, and he played a great first half and thought he deserved to start, and Taylor put his starters back in. Patio, the pull-up shot. Smart had it and then lost it, and Vegas has a possession. So ever since then, if someone plays well, he'll get to start the second half. And Bass Knight hits him with a field goal.
Brent, I'm going to throw something at you right here. Although you don't want to guard Wade because he's not a great shooter, I think it'd be smart to go ahead and put a man right in his face to take away those passing angles he's got. You know, he's out there just like in a rocking chair, and he can pick and choose his spots.
Indiana's ball, and now Thomas comes into the game, and Smart sits down. So Vegas ahead, 56-55. They were down by as many as 14 points. Alford fakes and gets inside Banks.
Steve Alford with the threat of the three-pointer. You almost have to go off your feet because you can't let him have that uncontested jumper.
17
great with
for the
pump
game
there.
To give the Hoosiers the lead. Banks is three again. That's 6 of 8 for Freddie Banks. 20 points for the game.
Callaway needed room. He wanted to drive on Patio that time, but Alford was in the way.
Here's Thomas. His second field goal.
Good job by him.
Gillian. Short and underneath was Wade. He'll come back and reset. Patio, quick move on Callaway. Up over Garrett. Gilliam, offensive rebound. He's fouled. He'll shoot a pair.
Now, Brent, another tough thing with Wade, if you're not guarding him, you're not blocking him out. So if you're not close to him, he sneaks in there and gets that cheap rebound. Wouldn't be bad for a couple of minutes to change that defensive strategy and say, Wade, I'm going to play you for a while. Let's see what you can do in that case.
So Isle only one away on fouling out of the game. Knight wanted to have a few words with Callaway, who returns. Gilliam at the line.
That hurts Bobby Knight because he can't go to that bench as deep as Jerry Tarkanian. Matter of fact, he doesn't want in a game like this have to go very far at all on that bench.
That's 21 for Gilliam.
For UNLV, number 32, Gary Graham.
And Graham returns.
Now, the reason for this substitution pattern, I think Jerry Tarkanian figures that he can rebound with Indiana with just Hudson and Gillum in there, so he really has gone to the three-guard offense. Bobby Knight gets a little counter here. He comes back in with another guard to save Isle for a while.
Joe Hillman. And Isle sits down.
Both coaches kind of matching up here.
Indiana down by two, 61-59. Here's Callaway. Traveled.
I don't know if he traveled on that play, and I think Bobby Knight's making a good point over there. It was an unusual looking step, but he still had his pivot foot on the floor. One you want to take a close look at. Anytime you do that unusual looking play, referees blow that whistle on you.
Wade left alone.
Now he faded.
Garrett off with the rebound. The three rattles out. Graham rebounds quickly to Banks. He puts one up on the move. Hillman's rebound for Indiana.
Good defensive job by Hillman on that play. He knew what Freddie Banks was going to do.
Thomas with a quick turn, and Garrett alone on the other side with the offensive rebound and a field goal. Deadlocked with 14:30 to go in regulation. Gilliam gets the roll.
Doesn't jump that high. He just has great positioning.
The screen's being set down low for Alford. Thomas against the double team. Comes up with the shot. Came back inside and he was fouled. That's the first on Hudson.
Okay,
Thomas tough inside. You remember at the start of this year, he was suspended from the club for a while because he wasn't going to class before any game started at all. He got the message in a hurry.
We've got a timeout at the 14-minute mark. It's a television timeout. We'll be right back. Enjoying the pictures today and now tonight from the Goodyear Blimp America out of Houston, Texas, the captain, John Moran. And inside the Superdome here in New Orleans, Vegas trailing at the half has taken a 63-61 lead, 14 minutes to go in regulation. And Mark Wade with 16 assists, and each one becomes a new record.
And Brett, that 16 assists, that's good for 32 points. So half of the points scored by Vegas this year have been directly off passes from Wade. IU has to figure out some way to shut him down in that area.
Well, good offer hit the cutter, Callaway, and he was fouled when he came up in the air. That's Graham's third personal.
There's Indiana rubbing those screens off on the inside. Callaway and Alford looking to come off double post. They really do it well. Indiana has not scored against man-to-man out of bounds, but I look for somebody to get a cheap one here one of these times. Oh, Wade caught over that screen beautifully. He gets caught on one there.
They sealed him, and that gave Alford enough time.
Nobody works without the ball any better than Alford does on those screens, like Scott May used to do on that great team that Bobby had in 1976.
Or Bill Bradley of Princeton. The three from Banks, not there. Garrett rebounds, and now Indiana can take the lead.
Notice how Indiana has cut the break off today. Vegas had not been able to get running.
The lead for the Hoosiers at 13-08, and it's Alford who backs up field goals.
Wade's got to feel like he's running among the trees in there trying to get through.
Graham, short. Callaway rebound. Alford spins inside on Wade, and Garrett underneath for the rebound is fouled by Robinson.
Here we talked about inside with Alford. Now watch Alford use his screens. There's Wade trying to fight over the top. Now that was an illegal screen moving over there by Thomas. Then Steve goes wide, and when Wade tried to fight over the top of the screen, Alford stayed down on the baseline to be wide open.
Here is the Indiana set on the out of bounds. That's three team fouls against Vegas this half, two against Indiana. Gilman catching Alford inside to Thomas. Callaway comes around to help. Back in low to Garrett. Against the double team, he goes to the glass.
What we're seeing right now, a clinic half-court offense by Indiana. They're taking great shots, great passing.
And Gilliam. Garrett knocks it out of bounds. So the JC out of the City College of San Francisco contributing here for Knight.
Brent, one of the reasons Vegas cannot get the break going is because Indiana is using the passing lanes so well, they're not taking any bad shots, so there are no wild rebounds.
Jarvis Bassnight into Tarkanian's lineup.
Patio's been sitting for a long time over there. Graham has not had a good game. I look for Patio to get back in here quickly.
Gilliam got the roll. That's 26 points.
Boy, Gilliam showing that he has such a soft shot. These are tight rims, but he just lays it up there and it sinks in.
Using Hillman at the point as Smart sits out, and Hillman burned him inside.
Basket counts. He caught it on the way up, on the way down. Basket was going anyway.
Boy, Joe Hillman really knows how to operate an offense. Sitting out there at the key, finding the open man and getting open himself. Oh. goes in, snaps a high pass.
Great defense by Garrett.
All the way there for the rebound.
Garrett altered the shot. Grant, I think Jerry Tarkanian's had a rough day substituting in this ball game. You notice that when he went in with a smaller lineup, it allowed Bobby Knight to use him in good pace.
And Alford right there. 23 for Alford. 71-65.
He's played into Bobby Knight's hands here by having a smaller team, which allows Knight to use a small club.
Gilliam comes back big for him and can't put it down, and Thomas. Now here's Joe Hillman. Tries one to Garrett off his hands. He recovers.
He
loose on the floor. Callaway up. And it's Hillman. Fast night reaching around Thomas. That's his second personal. Not yet in the penalty. So the ball will be taken out of bounds.
Foul is charged. Number 44, Jarvis Bassett.
Tarkanian wants a timeout. You could see Wade holding his hand at the table. Jerry Tarkanian wants a timeout. 71-65, 10-29. We'll be right back. At the Superdome, New Orleans, Louisiana. Already today, Syracuse advanced to the championship game, eliminating Providence. And they will meet the winner of this with Indiana up right now. And that's the final score for the Orangemen earlier today. Let's take a look at that pick, Billy, you were referring to.
Well, here's a case where you're screening a man with the ball. Wade gets picked off right there. Now watch what happens. Steve Alford showed the pass, froze the defense, and then went up for his jump shot. He's got the whole package. Really understands how to play the game.
Indiana on a 10-2 run over the last 4 minutes, and Vegas has hit only two of its last 12 shots.
And the pace of the game has been IU's pace. Alford was trying to draw a foul there. Took a bad shot, but he thought maybe he'd get fouled in the process. And he's talking to the official on the way down.
UNLV has also cooled off from three-point range. They hit the first three, and since then have missed five. There was a whistle blown on the inside as Graham came down. A summary of this game. Indiana 62% from the field. UNLV's 44 points from the front line. And Wade with 16 assists, a new tournament record, as Callaway is assessed his second personal. Now four team fouls against UNLV and three against Indiana. With the 10-minute mark.
Graham on a foul, trying to draw, make a move and screen. Brent, I think that Jerry Tarkanian has a lineup on the floor now that matches up and creates some problems for Indiana. Bringing Patio back in the ballgame. Watch Graham coming across, moving screen, calls the foul.
That's four fouls on Graham.
He's going to be sitting down here shortly with Banks coming back in there. Jerry Tarkanian will have his best club on the floor in a minute or so.
Matteo taking Callaway. Callaway goes right inside with him.
Great shot.
Gilliam coming way out to get the ball. Garrett has played with a lot more intensity since those two were pushing and shoving underneath a while ago.
You notice with Banks out of the game, nobody looking for the three-pointer. Game's all inside it. Alford's not within 20 feet of his man.
Garrett trying to deny Gilliam the ball. He gets it against a triple team. Comes up with a jump hook right-hander, and Thomas snaps away the rebound. And foul goes against Vegas. Jarvis Bassknight. His third. They don't want to get into the penalty too early here.
He's sitting back, relaxing. The winningest coach percentage-wise and active coach in basketball, and only stands behind Claire B in all-time winning percentage.
9 minutes with Banks hounding Alford.
Banks won the PCAA every single year he's coached a team in the league. Somebody got hurt inside. Thomas. I got to figure that was not just a stray elbow there. He got hit right in the chest. Lost his breath. And he's talking about it. Boom.
You think he couldn't throw a block as a tight end? Forearm shiver coming up there. And it's not like Thomas doesn't have a pretty good sized chest himself. There's Bobby, nice and calm.
He's probably thinking, Gilliam is my kind of player. He is a tough player down in that hole, let me tell you. Knocked away by Wade, didn't foul him, but Hillman is there again, picking up the loose ball.
Hillman makes no mistakes.
Knight wants Callaway inside. Off it off a fake. Now he gets inside. Bass Knight fouled him. That is his fourth personal foul as Alford goes to work on him.
Well, again, because of his great shooting ability, when he goes with those pump fakes, you almost have to go up there to try to block it. And then Alford just stays on the ground and goes ahead and gets off the easy shot. Now, Willard back in the game. Willard did not have a good first half in the few minutes that he played. Jerry Tarkanian's had a rough time for the substitution all day.
All right. Vegas already has committed seven personals this half. So the bonus coming up the rest of the way for Indiana. They have only three team fouls, and it's 73-65. And you just saw a rare sight with Alford missing one.
Missing
and now
what?
Two. I don't think I've ever seen that. I'm sure it's happened.
And Brent, does this remind you LSU? Remember the situation LSU was in with team fouls? Indiana only had four there late in the...
That was Hillman's foul. He was pushing Gilliam out of the way.
So that's only the fourth team foul.
Foul is charged to number 44, Joe Hillman.
Garrett just walked over to him and said, don't force it, Joe. Don't force it when you come through there.
You know what it means when you don't have a lot of team fouls. As it goes down to the wire, you can afford to give a foul, let them have the ball out of bounds.
Dick Paparo was huddling there with Banks and Alford and talking to the two veterans.
Second half has been Indiana's game style.
But that's Vegas' style, the three from Banks. Don't you ever count this bunch out. They are loaded with firepower.
Total team movement now. Everybody rubbing off screens.
This Hillman, off was he crunched. Banks on one side and Willard on the other. They sandwiched. Hillman and Banks picks up his third.
But you don't expect Hillman to score, but he goes and takes it inside, which is wise. If you're only going to show the pass, the defense can get accustomed to your style.
Shooting two, number 44.
So the winner of this game takes on Syracuse on Monday night. And again, a reminder, 8 p.m. Eastern time when we'll come on the air.
Ooh, Bobby Knight giving Wade a lot of earful on the sideline. Three fouls missed by two good free throw shooters. Bobby's first West Coast recruit.
So Wade brings it down. Hillman with Patio. This is Wade. And Patio's three is short. But the long rebound. And Banks misfires. And it'll go over. Touch last by Las Vegas. ...74-68, 7:28 in regulation. Here's Hillman coming down against the full court pressure, gets the ball into Garrett's hands, and then positions himself for the offensive rebound. And here's Alford. Bangs in. A two, and Knight is furious. They're calling it a two. They say that his foot was on the line.
Good call by the ref, but again, Brent, Hillman. How many times has he been there today?
And he's picked off by Willard. And that's an illegal screen on Willard.
Jerry Tarkanian not getting much out of Willard at all today. I think that's a change he's got to make.
I thought it was three when he went up.
No, he's got a part of the toe on the line.
Yeah, I agree.
You cannot touch it in any way, shape, or form. You can see right there, he's got part of that toe on the line. I'll bet you something here, Brent. He doesn't miss two on this one.
Keith Smart is returning for Knight.
For UNLV, number 32.
And now Gary Graham will replace Wade. He wants to give Wade a rest here at the 7-minute mark.
Well, the way Indiana is being patient with the ball, the rest may be a very big gamble on this on the part of Jerry Tarkanian now. He's going to have to go all out for the next couple of minutes.
27 points for Alford. It's a 10-point Indiana lead at the 7-minute mark.
Garrett doing a nice job on Gillum inside.
Alford is with Graham.
Ooh, nice pass.
A little wraparound for Hudson and Alford. His third.
But nobody goes to the foul line. You don't want to get a cheap one inside like that, but nobody goes to the foul line. Only the fifth team foul.
Billy, how can the Runnin' Rebels get this into their tempo? What must Tarkanian do now to turn this into an up-tempo schoolyard game, if you will, which they are devastating at?
Well, the problem is that when Hillman in the game, Alford was free, didn't have to handle the ball. Bobby Knight did a great job in that regard. They're just taking some bad threes inside.
Knight had a question at the table. That's Smart's fourth personal foul. So we're going to see Hillman before this is over. 6:28, 78-68. And the next one, they'll be shooting a one-on-one, and Gilliam takes Thomas back outside, and that's 28 points for Armin Gilliam here this afternoon. If this was a fight, you would say, you knocked Vegas down several times, but you can't knock him out. And Alford, coming around, was hit by Hudson.
Now there's a case for Hudson, just not quick enough to play Steve Alford, who gave him the little clutch move on the sidelines, just went right on by him. Easy call for the official.
For Indiana, number 12, Steve Alford shooting.
Well, really, more than any game that we have seen lately with Indiana, Alford seems to be taking charge offensively. As Hillman does return and Smart goes out.
One of the reasons for that, I think, Brent, we just saw him against LSU. LSU had a superior athlete that had size on Steve Alford. I don't think you can play him with a man of equal size, and certainly can't play him with a smaller man, because he took Wade, went right over him and around him with the screens. Wade coming back into the ball game now, patio out.
So for Tarkanian, Wade, Graham, Hudson, Gilliam, and Banks. This is a three-guard offense. Gilliam and Hudson, they're down by the 10-point difference at the 6-minute mark here in regulation.
You notice how Wade is not forcing the ball up the court quickly. He's kind of walking it up the floor.
Banks on the two. And Alford got a hand on it, and there's Garrett.
The other thing you're going to see Indiana start doing now, they're going to start playing clock by moving the ball out a little bit further. Hillman in the game, he can run this offense to perfection.
Callaway using the glass. He's only had two field goals here in the second half, but he made that one count.
Notice how quickly Indiana gets back on defense.
Garrett very active against Gilliam down in the blocks. Banks, and that's a two-point shot. And that's 25. Banks and Alford in a shoot 'em out here in New Orleans.
Uh-oh, Callaway coming down. It looks like he has a cramp and not a knee problem here. He's reaching for the back of his calf. Remember how he says it's a cramp. Remember how he went down in that LSU game? I never thought we'd see him back. He was out for five games this year with that knee problem.
Well, let me remind everybody while we have a quick moment here of what's coming up tonight after our basketball. Outlaws and the CBS Saturday movie, China Rose. That'll follow the basketball game.
Brent, I don't know why. If I'm Jerry Tarkanian, I'm up. I say you either got to call a timeout or you got to get him out of the ball game here. Callaway's still in, and no timeout was necessary. Bobby Knight got a break.
Callaway's a tough youngster out of Cincinnati. Played through that knee pain most of the season, offered short on that shot. Patio comes out, and Indiana is back defensively. There's Banks.
Boy, they'll pull up and take that three from anywhere.
28 points for Freddie Banks. 82-75, 4:48. They got Hillman. Callaway inside. Fine move.
Now Wade's starting to push it up court.
And he was blocked.
We haven't seen that much this second half, and that's the first time Wade really pushed it up there. That's what gets UNLV going.
The foul is charged to number 12, Steve Alford.
Now they're going to give it to Alford, which is his fourth personal at the 4:18 mark.
Team 7.
Well, obviously, Indiana can't afford that.
Timeout, UNLV.
Now, UNLV, Jerry Tarkanian has called this timeout at the 4:18 mark, so he has one to go. Indiana and a date against Syracuse in the championship game. There's the timeouts. Knight with four, Tarkanian with one. And you can see the team fouls both in the bonus now and the possession arrow, Indiana. Well, I've got a quick moment. I want to pass along our best wishes to Gene Peterson. He's the director of operations for CBS Sports. He's back in the hospital in the New York area, and I know he's watching this game this afternoon. And Gene, we have missed you out here in New Orleans. Steve Alford and the Hoosiers come back to work at the 4:18 mark, 84-75.
Jerry's starting to go ahead and chew on those fingers right now. He was here in 19. Here comes the shark chant. But he was there in 1977, the year that Al McGuire's Marquette team won, lost a tough game to the University of North Carolina.
Mark Wade has not scored a point this afternoon. But he has passed out 17 assists.
Six guys off that club that year, Brent, were drafted in the NBA. It's still a record. Now, no post offense right here. Kind of a spread by Indiana. And they run this as well as anybody that's played college basketball.
They've got Hillman.
Gee, what a game he's playing. They will get the backdoor cuts.
This is the three. Thomas and Callaway going up high along with Hudson. Hudson hitting the ball last, and it's Indiana's ball.
What you have there is a case for Freddie Banks trying to get back too much too quick.
Wade fouls Alford. That's three on Mark Wade, and Steve Alford gets to shoot one and one. What is so impressive about this Indiana team when you think about Knight is the fact that here this afternoon, off the bench, he has brought two players, Steve Isle and Joe Hillman, and they both technically have played the game so well. Yeah, he's tough, and yeah, he'll drill it into your head, but I guarantee you when you walk away from him, if you listen and you sort out the nonsense that he hands out, you'll know how to play the way he wants it played.
You know who has sat down most of the time? Keith Smarts, okay?
Right.
A kind of guy that would love to be challenged athletically by UNLV, and that's not what Bob Knight needed today. So he goes with a Hillman who will play within himself. I think Bob Knight has had the much of the better of it in regard to substitutions today.
Hudson. Hudson powers back for the rebound. Out of bounds. Vegas ball. There's a fellow who would have been a great player except for a knee operation, which caused him to miss an entire year before he came back for the Running Rebels, and that's Hudson.
You know, I mentioned to Hudson yesterday about the recruitment of Hudson. There's Bassnight back in. Hudson goes out. Jerry Tarkanian said they went to the championship game, and Hudson got in an argument with his coach, and most of the other coaches scouting him didn't want anything to do with it.
Ball on the floor. Reaching in was Callaway.
Big break.
Sure was.
Big break for UNLV.
The third personal on Callaway.
The arrow was facing down Indiana's way. They would have got the ball on a turnover.
It's 88-76. Indiana leading UNLV. Gary Graham returning. So the Shark wants to go with the three guards, Bassnight and Gilliam. Hasn't Gilliam played a great game for him, though, with 28 points down there?
Gilliam and Banks have both given him solid games. I think everybody else, you might say Wade also, but everybody else has actually played under their ability.
But Wade just wasn't able to hit any shots either, though.
He's not going to take many. Freddie Banks had a little special hairdo put together when he was at Vegas after the wins in the regionals. Had the number 13 carved into his head. Is that the right word, carved? I guess not. Tyler?
It looks like a carved job.
Shave, that's the better term. Appreciate it.
.315, Indiana up by 10.
And nice move by Hillman. Points are not important here. It's the clock that's the key. Hillman understands that perfectly. There he is again, being the man in the right place.
And a foul as Hillman got down the line. That's the fourth on Wade. Boy, Hillman is continuing to do a superb job here for the Hoosiers.
Well, Brent, the key when you're a substitution playing for Bob Knight is to understand what your role is and carry it out. Don't try to do any more or less than that. And that's what we're seeing right here. He's the guy that created tempo here in the second half and kept them in a half-court offense, so UNLV never could get running.
But there's still time for this bunch. Here's Banks looking for it as he went up in the air. He was fouled, and Hillman picks up his second.
Now you don't want to foul if you can help it. If you're Indiana, you'd just as soon rather have him put it up with a 10-point lead, make that clock keep moving. You know, the other thing that's interesting is today, I can't remember a time when UNLV made their press work. Well-drilled club from Indiana just took it away from them.
Well, that's the first time I've seen a Shark with a logo on a towel, and if he loses this, he'd go back to the plain white, folks. Enough of that bad luck. Down to eight. They go to the trap. And Alford uses a timeout. They had four. He saw he was in trouble. He alertly used the timeout. At the 2:39 mark, 88-80, Indiana, and we'll be right back. At the Superdome, New Orleans, Louisiana, with Indiana leading UNLV 88-80. You know, Billy, one story I want to mention before we get off the air, because it's a controversial one regarding Vegas. Lloyd Daniels, the young man that they've had some difficulty with out of the New York area recruiting. I got the feeling this year, and I told Jerry this to his face yesterday. I said, you know, Jerry, I thought you were turning it around with the public. They were beginning to sort of believe that you were running a real good program out there, and then you got involved with a young man who has brought more discredit to the school. He agrees, but he's not going to back away from the young man. He will never play for him at UNLV, but he said he still wants to help him go to school, a disadvantaged youngster. But he made it quite clear yesterday that he will never play at Las Vegas. So with 2:35 remaining, Indiana leading 88-80, they have possession. And Garrett missing, but Thomas on the other side, the position rebounding. Banks hits another three. That is has 35 points for Banks. He is 9 of 14 shooting threes.
The double team, Alfred sees it, good spin dribble.
Here's Hillman.
Backcourt. It was not backcourt, obviously. Five. Yep.
Goes over.
Now, what we see right now, Brent, is what happens to you. When you try to play a delay game and are not looking to score, the defense picks everybody up. Indiana can get an easy basket inside.
Now Banks, he and Gilliam have carried the load here in the second half. He forces that one, but Gilliam cleans up, scored, and bring him to the line. We got a new game. It's 90-85 with Gilliam on the line. They have 35 of UNLV's points in this half. Thomas on the floor, shaking up here at the 150 mark.
Here's Banks going in, double clutches it just to get it in the air was amazing. Now Gilliam comes down, he hits. And no foul should have been called on that because he's coming right down. He hit Thomas. And look at Gilliam's on the floor. He hit him with his elbow. Might have hit him in the crazy bone a little bit. And you can see that he's holding his elbow. Poor Thomas. He's seen enough of Gilliam today. One in the chest, one in the face. And again, we have that situation where a man's down. They'll have to either take him out or call the timeout. Bob Knight decides to go ahead and take him out. Now watch this. Right down on the face. Clean out by Gilliam.
Folks, we got a new game. This team is explosive. Gilliam can pull them to within four at the 151 mark.
Bob Knight goes back to three guards now. He has Smart in the game, and watch and see if Smart doesn't break free with Hillman and Alford handling the ball out front and take it to the hoop.
Banks with 35, Gilliam with 30.
Long.
Rebound Garrett. Graham is on Smart. They might want to put him on the free throw line. Here's Hillman. And now Hillman uses a timeout. They had three, remember. Two left. 138. Indiana up by five. We'll be right back. I'm Brent Musburger. 1:38 left in regulation. It's a 5-point game. Indiana over UNLV, 90-85 right now. Bob Knight just used a timeout, so the Hoosiers are down to two. Tarkanian is down to one timeout. The possession arrow, Indiana.
But they really have to be careful on this inbound situation because you know UNLV is going for the steal.
Knight elects to stick with the three guards. Hillman, Smart, and all.
Isle back in the ball game, trying to get a better ball handler in the game. Garrett goes out.
Also, Garrett was hitting only 61% of his free throws in the tournament. They hit Smart. Get it back to Hillman. Isle quickly. That's the one they do not want to put on the line. Now it's Smart. It's Hillman. Elected to pull it out. And Smart for the layup. And it's a big one. It's a huge layup. 92-85, 119. That could do it for the Hoosiers. Banks. Goes with it back with a three. They're not finished yet.
He's made them from both corners now.
Lead pass to Smart. Pretty soon they've got to put someone on the line. And there it is. Gilliam fouls Isle. So Steve Isle will be stepping up in a critical one-on-one situation.
And one of the few guys for Indiana that's not an outstanding free throw shooter. Only shooting 68% on the year.
And in the tournament, it's not even that good. It is 50%. Dean Garrett comes in for his rebounding. 102. What a great shooting performance by Buddy Banks here this afternoon. He has been unbelievable. Isle misses, and Vegas not finished yet with a minute to go.
Smart staying right with Freddie Banks.
Gilliam. They double him. Here's Banks. Isle comes up on him. He misses that one. Gilliam contesting Garrett. Loose, and here's Patio looking three. Rebound by Banks. Underneath.
Over the back. Over the back. Oh, me! I thought it was Gilliam over the back. That's what it was.
Exactly.
And I almost went through the ceiling there because it looked like they were pointing at Garrett.
Take a look at it, Billy, and see if it's a good call.
It is a good call. Right over the back. You see it right here. There's Gilliam coming right over Garrett's back. Garrett goes to the line. As you mentioned, not a good free throw shooter, but Indiana dodged a bullet here.
38 seconds and a 4-point lead. Garrett at the line in this game is 4 of 4. Missing. Callaway almost comes up with it. Rejected.
He's going to take the three on a break.
But he tracks it down. He'll go back outside, and Smart fouls him. That's his fifth foul. Smart fouls out of the game with 28 seconds, 92-88.
That's a foul that Hillman does not make. And although Smart has done a great job for Indiana this year, that was a mental mistake right there on his part, not a physical. You want to go ahead and just let Banks take it back outside. You can see Bobby Knight said, I don't want the foul. Don't want to stop that clock. And now Vegas is going to have to foul.
Indiana's struggles on the free throw line have left the running Rebels in this.
Now Garrett's in the ball game. I'm surprised Knight isn't taking him out, Brent.
One and one. No foul.
Back shooting 1-1.
He missed the free throw. Indiana, Alford with possession.
Can't foul him.
And they see Alford taken away from his man. He knew that if Vegas fouled in the backcourt, he wanted to come up here to the free throw line. He took charge of business back there.
Well, Kevin Houston of Army led the nation in free throw shooting this year. Each year it seems to get better and better. Houston shooting over 92%, but not a bad guy to have on the foul line if you want to seal up a game right here.
Alford 9 of 11 shooting free throws today. 31 points. We've had 3 30-point performances. There were a lot of people who tried to tell me that Bob Knight would never play this game in the 80s or the 90s. Yesterday when he came into the building, he said, I don't want to slow it down. I said, I don't think we can. 94-88, 20 seconds.
Of all people, Wade takes a three.
Isle, one hand on the ball, has got it from Hillman. Isle gonna go all the way. That's it. Indiana's gonna go to the finals.
And Brent, let me give you a stat. They've been there 4 times, and they've never failed to win the national crown. The team that leads that is UCLA, 10 for 10. Great drive by Isle.
And a man who enjoyed it more than anyone. Score it, and Bastnight fouls out.
Well, Brent, Vegas has lost twice this year, and we have done both games. Are we there, Jinx?
I'm sure you just made us a lot of friends out of Las Vegas. But, folks, I had nothing to do. I didn't shoot it. I didn't handle a clock today or nothing.
Jerry Tarkanian is denied for the second time. Going to the final game.
Dude, I think it bears repeating about that man right there. You give Knight 1 week to prepare for any team, and he's going to be real tough to beat. So we've got timeout being used on the floor, and let's talk about the matchup ahead of us. Indiana and Syracuse. Well, we've got a moment. Billy, your thoughts on that one?
Well, I think Syracuse showed us today they can come out and play some very, very tough man-to-man defense, and I think that is something that's extremely important.
because you've got to do that if you're going to play against IU because of Alford's great shooting ability. But I think IU showed something today in regard to great bench play. Super job by Isle and Hillman.
There's a former Knight assistant coach who now is very successful in his own right at Duke, Mike Krzyzewski.
Of course, Mike at this time last year was very happy as his club had worked their way to the final game beating Kansas. Bobby eliminated him this year. He's got a lot coming back next year. Expect Duke to be one of the teams on the scene. Not only an assistant under Bobby, but he played for Bobby.
Well, the two teams who live by the three-point play all season long died by it here this afternoon. Providence eliminated earlier by Syracuse 77-63. Vegas will fall, but they threw up 35. And there is Lois Tarkanian. The disappointment of traveling this far and then coming up a loser.
They were the nation's number one team for more weeks than anybody else this entire season.
Six seconds to kill with a six-point lead.
How about the deployment here by Bobby Knight? Throwing the ball to half court and saying to Vegas, you can have it.
Let's him have two tap-ins. And that one fell for two. Dick Paparo says that counts. Score that tap-in. The ball was up on the rim. And Knight, Tarkanian, shake hands at midcourt. We're going to come back. We'll hear from Bob Knight and Dean Garrett when we continue in a moment.
Knight has done it. He'll be heading to the national championship game on Monday night, looking for his third national title. The Chevy MVPs in this game, Armand Gilliam for UNLV, 30 points and 8 rebounds. And Steve Alford out of Newcastle, Indiana, 33 points as the Hoosiers advance on to take on Syracuse Monday night for the championship. Let's go back down to the courtside, Brenton Billy.
All right, Jim, thank you. We're with Coach Knight and one of the young men who has traveled that journey to the championship, Dean Garrett. Dean, your thoughts about this victory?
Hey, this is a great victory. Everybody thought we weren't going to win it. People were putting us down by 3 points and saying Gilliam was going to do this. UNLV was too fast for us. But, hey, this shows you, we're a strong team ourselves and we, we're not quitters at all.
Bob, I thought you got an incredible game off the bench today. Two guys came in and really used their heads to set a lot of things up. Steve Isle and Hillman.
Well, Hillman and Isle played very well for us in the regional and have played very well for us in a lot of situations all year. And that's what we recruited them for, to play very well for us.
It was a thinking man's game in regard to substitution patterns and the way that you played.
And you still understood it?
I think I did. And I thought you really did a super job taking advantage. When they went with a smaller club, let you stay with Hillman for a long time.
Well, what happened? There had to be a lot of changes made. It was really a hot day. And I thought the UNLV kids were just absolutely plastered, their jerseys. I thought our kids did a heck of a job hanging in the last 10 minutes. I thought we might just get worn down and be worn out in the last 10 minutes.
All right. Gentlemen, congratulations. Good luck Monday night. James Brown is standing by with Jerry Tarkanian. Let's go to James.
All right, Brent. Thank you very much. Coach Tarkanian, you had your team in the locker room a very long time at halftime. What did you see in what Indiana was doing that you were trying to counter?
Well, the first half, I didn't think that we played as hard as we could defensively. And secondly, we didn't play well, and yet we were only six down, so we kept thinking that we could come back. We just felt there was a few things. We just had to toughen up our defense and get more intense and get up in the passing lanes, which we didn't do. We were in our defense was tougher about 10 seconds, and then it broke down, and we didn't sustain it today. We came to a big game like this, and we weren't as quick as we'd been earlier in the year, and it's a painful loss, but I'm so proud of this team that it hurts a lot, but I'm extremely proud of our ball club, and
Yeah. Obviously a tough loss, but you wore number one very well. Coach, thank you very much.
Thank you.
All right, Brent, back to you.
All right, James, thank you. And for Billy Packer, Jim Nance, James, and Billy Cunningham, I'm Brent Musburger. So long from the Superdome in New Orleans. That final score again, Indiana 97, UNLV 93. NCAA basketball has been a presentation of CBS Sports.